decided to worship with us this morning, whether you're worshiping live on Facebook or later on in the week on YouTube, we're just so glad that you're worshiping. We would love to hear from you. Comment below and just let us know what you're enjoying and how your weekend is going. This weekend is a special weekend. It is 4th of July weekend, which means we get to honor the strides of our freedom and our independence and the freedoms that we are getting to enjoy here in this country. Just because the church is closed, the church doors are closed, does not mean the church isn't working. There are so many things going on in the life of our church, especially as we're going to be opening soon for small groups and Sunday school classes to meet. Scott will be talking more about that later in the service. But that means that we're starting to do more and more things, but we are still being safe. We are still wearing our masks, and we're still being responsible and following that first rule of Wesley, what John Wesley's, which is do no harm. The worshipers here that are volunteering this morning are all wearing masks when they are not participating in worship. So one of our announcements this morning, the youth and the children's ministries are doing a mission project as they're going to be meeting in the next few weeks. We're going to be putting together encore hygiene kits. Our goal is to make
We are glad that you're worshiping with us this morning, and we want to take a moment before we have our prayer time to let you know about how we are starting the reopening process. We are beginning by starting with small groups first, at least through the month of July, up to around August the 9th. Now, in order to reserve a space for your group to be, you will need to contact the church office and retrieve a form to fill out. On that form, there will be the 5 days that the church is available to be open and the 5 or 6 places where you can meet. We are not opening up the whole church for anyone to meet anywhere at any place. Instead, what we're going to be doing is giving you an opportunity to safely meet. That means wearing masks, having your temperature taken when you come into the building, and going into a room that has been cleaned before you arrive. And then allowing you to also follow the social distancing guidelines that are currently in place. So once you fill out the form, then that is submitted to the church office, and we will do our best, based on the limited amount of space and limited time that we have for groups. We will get you reserved for a space where your group can be in a way that wouldn't have been planned and spent. We're not having to go to the huge expense of cleaning every room every day. No room in the church will be used more than twice a day, once in the morning and once in the afternoon or the evening. So if your group would like that opportunity to meet again, fill out those forms and we'll be glad to try to schedule a time for your group to be able to meet. Let us go to our Lord in prayer. Gracious and loving Father, we acknowledge that each and every gift that comes into our lives passes first through your hands. We realize that some of the greatest gifts we've ever received are those who hold close to us. And no matter what COVID-19 has done, it hasn't erased our hope in the resurrection. If so, it's made us even more aware of your grace and your mercy that is found through Christ's death and his resurrection from the grave. So help us all to reach out to any who are grieving. May I offer words of comfort to them. Words that remind them of the promise that our loved ones who know Christ as Lord and Savior never falls, but are found in you. We pray for those who are sick. As more and more tests are being done, we are discovering that more and more people are facing COVID-19. We pray for those, especially for those be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Thank you.
gifts that have benefited the church as we have gone out to be a benefit to our community and world. We pray that you will receive the gifts we offer from the heart that gives them, with love and adoration, but most of all, with gratefulness for the gifts you've shared with us. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Come, you sent us poor and needy, weak and wounded, sick and sore, and then we will hear from Mr. Bill Dennis.
Thank you.
Our scripture lesson for today comes from the Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 11. We'll be looking at verses 16 through 19 and then 25 through 30. Listen for the word of God. To what will I compare this generation? It is like a child sitting in the marketplaces, calling out to others. We played the flute for you, and you didn't dance. We sang a carol song, and you didn't mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he has a demon. Yet the Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, look at the glutton and the drunk, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. But wisdom is proved to be right by her works. At that time, Jesus said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you've hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have shown them to the babies. Indeed, Father, this brings you happiness. My Father has handed all things over to me. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son wants to reveal him. Come to me, all you who are struggling hard and carrying heavy loads, and I will give you rest. Put on my yoke and learn from me. I'm gentle and humble, and you will find your rest for yourselves. My yoke is easy to bear, and my burden is light. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts together be acceptable in your sight, we pray. Amen. We're not going to like very much what this scripture is saying to us on this Independence Day weekend, but Jesus has a question to ask us through this scripture. Jesus has crowded into our holiday weekend to ask us this question: are you free? Are you free? Isn't that just the type of question that we would expect from Jesus? Here we are in the midst of celebrating our nation's independence, claimed and won more than two centuries ago. Words like freedom and liberty have punctuated our surroundings along with red, white, and blue flags and curlicues. Isn't it just like Jesus to reign on our 4th of July weekend to remind us of this question? Yes, you're celebrating your independence, but are you free? Jesus doesn't actually ask that question with those exact words, but it's a question that pervades the whole book of Matthew, especially this chapter of Matthew, where Jesus finds himself repeatedly surprised by people's evident lack of freedom to respond to who he is and what he is teaching. Early in chapter 11, he has seen that his cousin, John the Baptist, does not even recognize him as being the one, the Messiah. Jesus has complained of those who look at him and think that he spends too much time eating and drinking, too much time partying, and apparently they find themselves hard to take him seriously. He has even chided the people of the city in which he has settled down, Capernaum, for they have seen his good works day after day after day, and yet they too respond in a similar method. I'm not seeing anything really special in Jesus. Not seeing Jesus as the one who can let their captive soul be free. I wonder, how are we any different than those of Jesus' time? How different are you and I, when we see the things of this world that bind us and hold us? How free are we? Jesus is asking us, are you free? Are you free to respond to what I am offering? So are we free? That's an interesting way to inquire about the whole subject. When we talk about freedom, we tend to think of the hard-won freedoms that we cherish under our Constitution. We stand on those freedoms 200 plus years after the Declaration of Independence. Those freedoms of religion, of speech, of assembly, the freedom of the press, and the freedom from unreasonable search and seizure, the freedom from cruel and unusual punishment. All of these and many more have been tested and elaborated upon and celebrated over the course of our nation's history. But Jesus seems to be talking about something else when he turns and asks us, are you free? We aren't always free to respond to Jesus. We are busy. Our calendars get so full of activities, appointments, and to be done lists that we cannot find an open slot for our Savior. Jesus experienced that in his time, if you recall, when the young man was called to follow after Jesus, and the man replied, I will follow you. I'm almost ready, but give me 3 days to bury my father. There are other things that keep us from responding to Jesus' offer of freedom. One thing in particular is the grip of addiction. Whether it's to substances, to pornography, to work, or even to shop, our addictive behaviors blur our ability to see things clearly. It saps our self-esteem and redirect our energies away from what could have been directed towards Jesus Christ. We also aren't free to respond to Jesus as he would have us to if we are bound by a financial situation that we cannot control. Maybe it's bad decisions that we've made in the past, or maybe it's the bad economy that comes and shakes up our financial security. It doesn't take us long in those circumstances to feel and to recognize how financial debt can enslave us. And then there are other conditions that interfere with our freedom in less tangible ways. The frayed social safety nets, the higher taxes that may be coming, the having to work harder for health care, and sometimes feeling as if all of our hard work gets us very little in return. There is also the increased stratification of our society. No longer are we a nation united, but we are a nation divided. We are allowing people to divide us up into groups when we forget that we are one people under God. We get so caught up in the world around us and all of the happenings that sometimes it feels as if we could just throw our hands up in the air and say, Jesus, I know you want us to make you in a higher place in our list of things to do. We know that you want us to make you the highest priority, but it's hard, and I just don't know how. To that, I think Jesus would just simply smile and say, yes, you just hit the nail on the head. And if you were to press Jesus to explain what he meant by freedom, I think he would say this. I think he would say, you are still trusting in your wisdom. You are still trusting in your intellect to free you. How foolish is that? I am your freedom. Can you say that right now? Just those four words. I am your freedom. Who's our freedom? Jesus is our freedom. An old hymn looks like this. Make me a captive, Lord, and then I shall be free. Some of you may scratch your head. How can that be? Making someone a captive and yet that person is free. Can captivity be a precondition for freedom? For those of us who assume that freedom wide open spaces and unbounded self-determination, then this kind is confusing to us. But it may be helpful to remember that even our nation's founders knew that freedom and liberty involved some things that you just couldn't cut away from it. In other words, our freedom and desire for our freedom doesn't come easy with no strings attached. In 1776, 1776, when the Patriots signed the Declaration of Independence, they were binding themselves to a long-standing fight. The earnest dedication that they had in their hearts when they signed the Declaration of Independence did not mean that they were suddenly completely free from the confines of England. They would still have to fight for that which they claimed. It would take 7 years, all the way to 1783, before that freedom would become a reality. And in the course of those 7 years, if they had any doubts at the beginning, they definitely knew at the end that freedom is costly. Freedom does not come cheaply. It does not come easily. Freedom then and freedom today takes great cost. In the final words of the Declaration of Independence, the signers of the Declaration of Independence name what that cost is, what freedom truly costs. It costs our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor. And if they were to sing that song, "Make Me a Captive, O Lord," they would probably say, "Make me a captive to for freedom. And if I live, then I shall be free." Nor does this independence for which our founders found themselves release those who follow into an unfettered future. The Declaration describes a nation of men, and we would also have women, who are all created equal, whose right is to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness that will be secured by a government that exercises just powers without debating politics or the proper reach of the government and its role in protecting especially the most vulnerable. It is clear that such a nation cannot offer to each of its citizens absolute freedom to do whatever they please. Justice requires that our liberties be limited to the extent necessary to guard one another's rights. Let's talk about free will. Free will is that gift that makes us in the image of God. It is the gift that is given to the original settlers on this planet, Adam and Eve. When God says, "Let us make them in our image," he's referring to the ability that we will be able to make our own future, to make choices that would direct us upon our paths. That is free will. But then there is a tricky side of free will. When my free will infringes upon someone else, when my free will causes harm, and it's no longer right. It is no longer good. It is no longer holy. In our great world that we live in right now, people are getting mad over wearing masks. They are pulling guns on one another. They are pitching a royal fit, no matter who can see them, saying that they are not going to wear a mask, never will, and not all the time. They have their freedom. But most of the people that I know that have contracted COVID-19 have done so within the month of June and July. Brothers and sisters, this concept of freedom also always requires us to keep in mind the welfare of our brothers and our sisters. It is because we are adults that we take on the responsibilities of being safe one another. It is because we want to be truly free to love one another that we take on extra responsibilities in order to protect that which has been made free for us. You see, justice requires that our liberties be limited to the extent necessary to guard one another's rights. And our ability to exercise free will is wonderful as long as we do it in a healthy way.
wants today, saying, you may be free, but I'm here to make you truly free. And then we suddenly notice that he's holding something. Jesus is extending out to us a yoke. Some of us may not be very familiar with a yoke. What images of farming that we have seen? We've seen nice fancy tractors that are now powered by GPS working out in the fields. We may only see photos of yokes being tied to oxen or horses in history books. But the point of a yoke was to tie together the animals that would be producing the power for the farmer, to pair them up with this heavy piece of wood that would rest upon their shoulders. U-shaped bends around to secure it upon each one. It was a way to ensure that both animals always marched in step. And Jesus is extending a yoke to you and I. He says, take my yoke upon you. This yoke is kind, and my burden is light. Now, it doesn't take many wise and intelligent folks to begin to see a flaw in this whole concept. The wise will say, hold on. I distinctly remember Jesus saying, take up thy cross. I'm not too sure that I'm going to take up this yoke. And the intelligent will think to themselves, you know what, I bet he means something a little bit deeper here. And perhaps they might even remember the words that are often spoken during the Christmas season. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressors, you have broken. The intelligent, hearing these words anew amid the patriotism of this season, will want to probably think this through. What yoke is Jesus replacing with his? Soon they'll begin to wonder, could Jesus be re-challenging the yoke of racism in America? Could Jesus be challenging the yoke of political ideology in America? Could Jesus be challenging the yoke of social justice in America? The intelligent will begin to worry about the political, social, and economic costs of taking on this yoke of Christ. But the question is, will you reach for? Who are the ones, according to this scripture, that reach for this yoke? Only the infants, the innocents, and the sinful. Jesus says, I thank you, Father, because you have hidden these things from the wise and from the intelligent, and have revealed them to the infants. Jesus wasn't referring only to little children. Then you can imagine a child reaching out for the yoke that their friend Jesus is handing them. That child looking at the texture of wood, feeling the depth of the wood, and then beginning to wonder what it would be like to be yoked with your friend Jesus. Jesus is beginning to discover that only those who come to him with wonder and simplicity, just like children, have sufficient freedom to receive what he has to offer. Come to me, he says to them. And that's the same invitation he issues to us. Discover the freedom of resting in my love and my teachings. You will find rest for your souls. With the patriots, we know that freedom demands the commitment of our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor. But we also know that those who lose their life for my sake will find it. And so reaching for that yoke that Jesus is preparing for us, reaching for it and forsaking all others that would hold us back from it, we too can then sing, Lord, make me a captain, and then I shall be free. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Today is the first Sunday of the month, and we invite you to participate with Holy Communion. deserve Holy Communion today. We'll be going through the liturgy that is found in the Methodist Synod on pages 12 through 14. It may also be projected on the screen behind me. So I hope that you're now at your table, or you have a coffee table set up between you and whoever else may be watching at home and worshiping with us, because together we can celebrate this great meal that our Father has prepared on our behalf through Jesus Christ. Receive the invitation that comes from Christ himself. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sins before God and one another. Together we pray. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Brothers and sisters, hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves his love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. May the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. Deliver us from slavery to sin and death, and meet with us a new covenant by word and the Spirit. On the night which he gave himself up for us, he took breath, lifted it towards the heavens, giving thanks to his Father above. And then he broke the bread and passed it among his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body, broken for you. Do this as often as you eat it in remembrance of me. After the supper, he took the cup, raised it towards your heavens, giving thanks to his Father above, and then passed it among his disciples, saying, drink from this each of you, for this is my blood, the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink from it in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Let us pray. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine, may them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Brothers and sisters, now is the time for you to take the bread on your table. It's an ordinary table, probably, not a fancy table that we might would have in a place of worship. This one's just a round, it has some ornate features to it, but it's still just a table. It may be similar to the table where you're kneeling at, or where you're sitting at right now. It may look very different. It may even look like a table that is rolled up to your bed. As you are in a hospital or under hospice care. When I often visit people, especially if I'm visiting a home where there are some older adults who do not get up as easily, I will often kneel or sit in the floor between them. And that's the image I think of every time when I come to a table, especially a table like this. A place where we can gather together on our knees and remember all that we've been blessed with. We've been blessed to have bread. I invite you to break it down. I invite you to pass it around to each other, saying, this is his body, broken for me. And then, some of you may not be able to have grape juice. You may be using orange juice or apple. Some may be using water because that's the only thing you have. Some may not be good Methodists, and somehow their grape juice is turned into wine. But for us, it represents the very blood of Christ, our Lord and Savior, who allowed his blood to be poured out for us. And as we receive communion this morning, as the cup comes to our hands, we are reminded that the very drops that still fall represents the drop of the blood of our Savior that he allowed to fall when he was nailed to the cross. You see, it really doesn't matter what the table looks like for your Holy Communion. Doesn't matter if you got bread that is yummy tasting, or you've gone with that gluten-free bread, which for some is not as tasty. It doesn't matter what really is in the cup. What really matters is who is in your heart and who is in your table. Let us pray. We thank you, O Lord, for the gift of the table. Place where we can gather and meet the one, the only one, who can truly give us freedom. It is in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
ourselves yoked with. Some by our own choosing. Others, we just scratch our head, wondering how we fell in step with a person or thing that has us locked out of joy, of grace, of fulfillment. But if we will only give ourselves fully to Jesus, then we'll discover, just like a child, how fun it can be to carry a yoke of any size. As long as Jesus is in the other arena with us. Brothers and sisters, it's a simple thing to wear a mask. It's a simple thing to offer love and kindness to those who are afraid or who may be sick. It's a simple thing to carry a heavy burden like the problems of this world when you are happy with the one you are yoked with. Jesus said, come, take my yoke. It is light, and the burden is not heavy. Will you take that yoke today? Will you discover, maybe for the first time, what it really means to be free? In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.